Yo, this is Mike from Orange Grove saying big ups, enough respect and love to What's Up TV. You know, they got the all access going on. What's going on around the islands, you know. Keep it locked. What's Up TV got the parties covered.
The island of Saba is the unspoiled queen of the Caribbean. A tranquil paradise. If you have never stepped foot on this magical gem, then you are missing out on something special. Saba is 5 square miles, a volcanic island rising 3,000 feet from its highest point. After a good night's sleep at our host hotel, I took an early morning hike up to Mount Scenery Trail of 1,064 mossy stone steps, better known as the Stairway to Heaven. On the way up, I experienced a beautiful rainforest jungle of ferns, tropical flowers, and numerous other trees. When I reached the summit, the view was just phenomenal.
Well, you know, Saba is not a beach island, obviously, so people come for the nature. So not even realizing it, we've always been an eco destination. We have 2 eco lodges on Saba, and those are usually the hotels that fill the fastest. Not primarily because they're less expensive than some of the others, but more and more people are looking for this type of travel, this type of accommodation as well.
In addition to the nature trails, Saba is blessed with an abundance of fish in its marine park. Visitors and experienced divers come from far and near to navigate Saba's underwater world. Past volcanic activity has created spectacular formations and structures. Unusual and exciting encounters are always possible in Saba waters. And those are just some of the reasons why Saba was chosen the best island in the Caribbean.
And we, of course, got the award for the best island of the Caribbean for 2010. Very prestigious award. We're very happy with it, very proud of the island. And I think because the island is so unique and characteristic, the people are friendly, no crime, all of these went toward or getting this.
It's July, the time of the year when Saba enjoy carnival.
Well, of course, you know, Saba's a small island, and this is by far the biggest cultural event, and it's something that everyone looks forward to every year. And you see a lot of Saba people actually coming back to the island during the summer period just to come back home for carnival. And this year is 35 years that we've celebrated carnival here, and it's been one of the biggest celebrations, I would say.
Saba Carnival started back in 1975 with the assistance and a hard-working, community-minded Saban woman by the name of Mrs. Carmen Simmons.
When I had my own for the 5 years, not the 4 years then, you know how we fundraise? We fundraise with all the bars and restaurants. We asked them if they would mind letting us keep a party. They keep a party, and if we collect at the door, that'd be our own, and then they keep the bar and so. And most of them, they agreed, and that the way, like every week on the Saturday, we kept a little something in these different bars. But not on the field to say, well, you have a whole day of confusion. It was just on the Saturday. And that went on, I would say, you know, lively, happy, no drunkenness, no fighting, no nothing. Just real joy, happiness.
You have differences, but you also have very similar aspects. And of course, one of the similarities that then expands to the differences here in Saba is that when you start off, it's of course a gathering where so many people come out and then it becomes a big meeting place. And we see that in many places. Here, I think you have a more intimate feel to carnival. It's smaller, yet very live, very colorful usually, and in numbers we might be much smaller than the other islands, but the efforts and the energy that is expressed here by our revelers beats many.
We caught up with Carl at a mass camp in the Windward Side, where everyone was chipping in to make the costumes come to life.
We wanted to do something that is typical or reflective of the island territory of Ceiba. And last year, right after our 31st carnival, the Sea Fan Society board and its members, its patriotic revelers, I would say, had decided on a theme that would be very reflective of that. And we came up with the theme Ceiba Heritage, a melting pot of cultures. And this really could be interpreted in many ways, but the interpretation we gave to it was Ceiba's heritage reflected in the sense of the various hands that the island territory changed over the last centuries, particularly to the ownership of which of the kingdoms Ceiba belonged, and as such it will be reflective of the Dutch kingdom, the English kingdom, or the Great Britain, also of the Spanish kingdom, and that of the French. And obviously we'll also have a section that will be reflective of the Amerindians that were the first settlers on the island.
Yeah, but if I think about it now, everything has come so expensive that it's so much different if you can get a group of children and just say, okay, let's make a nice Hawaiian group. Pretty, you know, nice. At least it'd be a different. But no, everybody's just concentrating on a set of feathers you will see for yourself. That's not the idea. Have a different feathers, Hawaiian, Indians. You know, you have different kind of Indians. We had an Indian group with clothes with stripes on the bottom of them. And then it was like a big joke, you know. And then we would say, we would beat the drum. And then they said, oh, are you going to bring rain? You beat the drum for rain. And so said rain came down. Everybody said, oh, the Indians have brought rain, you know. So it's fun.
I remember in the early days when the Lions Club was hosting Carnival. I mean, it was a very well-organized and well-oiled float, very routine. I mean, we knew where we were at and we knew where we were going. And now we have a new, Lions did step out a few years ago, which was, in my opinion, a big loss. But it was initially also the Lions Club did it as a fundraiser. And towards the end, it was really, it grew so big that it was more of an expense than a fundraiser to them. So they had to let it go for looking at what their mission was. But there have been a number of foundations that have taken it on. And then recently, in the last couple of years, we have had the Ceiba Cultural Foundation with Miss Lisa Hassel spearheading that, and she's been doing a phenomenal job at really keeping Carnival going on this island.
You are an intricate part of the not only the promotion, but the parade and the organization itself. What is your general impression of this year's festivities?
It was quite nice. I've had calls this morning from people who said that the parade was very colorful.
But to me, it's not coming from the committee. I don't know the committee. I didn't even put on the committee. I must thank the committee for remembering me for the 75 years, and I would say they gave me a very good plan. I appreciate it, thank them very much, but I don't know exactly who's who on the committee. But I wouldn't say it's the committee. But to me, I feel that the community is not involved enough. They should take more part and the community should get more involved. And I mean, help yourself. Don't look only for the community to help you. Let the community get together and do something. I know my last group I had about 50 people, children and adults. And we, ours was no feathers, we was Ceiba rainbow. The white clouds and all the three different colors and from the rain, the umbrella and the fans and the different things. That's the idea of Carnival. You make different kind of things. So then the community have to do it.